books that essentially are my favorite books from the last 3 years. So, if you missed part one, here's a quick catch up of what we're doing. Essentially, I filmed my favorite books of all time. And in that video, I said that favorites have a 3-year waiting list and they're books I have to have reread and still enjoyed, because sometimes books don't hold up for me on a reread. And I had also mentioned in my favorite video that I do have a bachelor's degree in English Lit. I was so burnt out by the time I finished that degree that I essentially just didn't read anything new for like 8 years, which is why I have more potential favorites from the last 3 years than I did from like basically my lifetime before that. Because by the time I finished that degree, I forgot how to read, essentially. So it was only in the last 3 years, sometime between 3 and 4 years ago, my best friend added me to a Facebook group. And the other people in that Facebook group, specifically Deidra from Shade Tree Reads and Hayoon, who is not on YouTube, they reminded me that I love reading. And they introduced me to this world of diverse books that I had not been aware of before. So my bachelor's in Lit, I read one book by a black author, and that was Their Eyes Were Watching God by Zora Neale Hurston. Did not read a single book by an Asian author. No indigenous authors. Nothing. I think my dog is gonna join us here. Hi, baby. She hurt her toenail, so she is very sad. She has a coma, and it is making her life very difficult right now. It's really heartbreaking. Hey, look, a distraction. So, all that to say that in the last 3 years I've made an actual active effort to read more diversely, and it's really reignited how much I love to read and my enjoyment in books, which is why I have so many books now that I'm so excited to talk about that I didn't have before. And I'm so glad that I'm discovering all of these new authors and new to me books and genres that I had never considered before. And even just twists on classics. So the first book that I'm going to talk about in this video is Mexican Gothic by Sylvia Moreno Garcia. So this book was a really fun twist on the kinds of books that I read when I was getting my lit degree. I did my capstone project on the phase of the novel, and that's where we start to see these gothic heroines show up. And I've always loved, you know, the Bronte sisters and Dracula, Frankenstein, those gothic horror stories really spoke to my heart then, and they still do now. So this was a super fun read for me. It's very dark and atmospheric. It can feel a little claustrophobic. It's all taking place in, like, inside this one house. If you are a person that likes trigger warnings, look them up for this book. I'm not going to tell you what they are. I have feelings about trigger warnings, and maybe I'll do a video on that one of these days. But I will say, from just a very personal standpoint, they can ruin a book for me. So I don't look at them before I pick a book up. So, Mexican Gothic. Very classic gothic vibes with a really delightful twist of, you know, taking place in Mexico. So, from the back of the book it says, "From the author of Gods of Jade and Shadow comes a reimagining of the classic gothic horror novel, a story about an isolated mansion in 1950s Mexico and the brave socialite drawn into its treacherous secrets. After receiving a frantic letter from her newlywed cousin, Naomi Tabato heads to High Place, a distant house in the Mexican countryside. Naomi is an unlikely rescuer. She's a glamorous debutante, more suited for cocktail parties than amateur sleuthing. But she's also tough, smart, and not afraid. Not of her cousin's new English husband, a stranger who is both menacing and alluring. Not of his father, the ancient patriarch who seems fascinated by Naomi, and not even of the house itself, which begins to invade Naomi's dreams with visions of blood and doom. Naomi's only ally in this inhospitable place is the family's youngest son, but he too may be hiding a dark secret. As Naomi begins to unearth stories of violence and madness, she is slowly drawn into a terrifying yet seductive world, a world that may be impossible to escape." So if you like the yellow wallpaper, you will like this book. yeah, really good. Highly recommend. Kind of a little bit obsessed with Sylvia Moreno Garcia. Over here. She's another one that I'm trying to collect the entire back catalog on now, because I've now read 4 of her books and absolutely love them. I love the way that she, like, vaults across genres with her stories. So it's kind of fun. Like, this is classic gothic horror. Gods of Jade and Shadow is fantasy. The Beautiful Ones feels more like reading an Austen novel. Certain Dark Things, Vampire Story, they're just all, like, really radically different from each other. And I'm really especially looking forward to reading Prime Meridian and The Daughter of Dr. Moreau. Those are, like, next on my list from her. So, if gothic horror isn't necessarily your bag, don't write off Sylvia Moreno Garcia as an author, because she's got a lot of books and they're all so radically different from each other that I feel like any reader could find something from her catalog that they would enjoy. Just amazingly diverse storyteller. Mexican Gothic takes place in the 1950s. The next book I'm going to talk about takes place in the 1920s, but feels much more modern. And that is The Monsters We Defy by Leslie Penelope. I picked this book up essentially on impulse because I liked the cover. I mentioned in my video last week that, like, I definitely have a thing for the covers of books, despite the fact that I don't. You can't see the covers of any of my books. I need another bookshelf so that I can have more space on these, so that I can do, like, cute facings of pretty covers so that people can see. So yeah, picked this up on impulse. And I don't usually go for prohibition stories. I find that they've just sort of been, you know, been there, done that, moving on. But this was really good. It is set in 1920s Washington, D.C. in the Black District. All of the characters are Black. It's also got, like, spooky atmosphere. It's a ghost story. It's a mystery heist. There is a queer character. We get to go to a drag ball in the 1920s, which is fun. Just really fast-paced. Hooks you in. I read the whole thing in a day. It helped me bust a reading slump last year, and I will probably use it as a slump buster again sometime in the future, but this was probably my favorite read from last year. It was the one that anytime when someone was like, recommend a book, what was your favorite? I was like, The Monsters We Defy. So from the back of the book, it says, Clara Johnson can talk to spirits, a gift that saved her during her darkest moments, now a curse that left her indebted to the cunning spirit world. So when a powerful spirit offers her an opportunity to gain her freedom, Clara seizes the chance, no questions asked. The task, steal a magical ring from the wealthiest woman in the district. Clara can't accomplish this daring heist alone. To pull off the impossible, she'll need the help of an unlikely team. From a handsome jazz musician able to hypnotize with a melody, to an aging actor who can change his face. But as they race along DC's legendary Black Broadway, conflict in the spirit world begins to leak into the human one. An insidious mystery is unfolding, one that could cost Clara her life and change the fate of an entire city. Super fun book. Highly recommend if you like thrillers. Don't let the ghost story aspect put you off. They're not. This is not like quite Casper the Friendly Ghost, but they're not like. I wouldn't say it's as scary as The Taking of Jake Livingston levels of ghost story. How's that for a scale? On a scale of Casper to Jake Livingston. It has spooky elements, but I wouldn't call this one horror. I would call it a mystery or a heist story. Seattle. It does not take place in Seattle. Nothing in this book happens in Seattle other than a mention of the ferry that will take you from Vancouver to part of my personal challenge to read a queer book from every state. So this is Alaska. It takes place in Alaska, and our main character, Tova Agard, is a lesbian and two-spirited. So she is a member of the Tlingit tribe in Alaska. And this is... So it's a... She's nominally the main character insofar as there is a main character. But this is less a, you know, plot from point A to point B, following one person's story. It jumps through time. It doesn't tell the story in order, and it's written as a collection of legends. So the back of the book says, Tova Agard's world is literally falling apart. She's just been disowned by her father in a violent confrontation over her sexuality, and climate change is about to wreak havoc on the world. In the midst of catastrophe, Tova meets Smithsonian Institute ethnologist John Swanton on an Alaskan ferry time machine. Trapping Swanton in Tova's small hometown of Wrangell Island, Tova convinces Swan that the island's contemporary stories are worth collecting, despite their strangeness. In Tova's oral traditions, a woman becomes a bear, a man marries a tree, a UFO hunts deer, and the dead go to Seattle. These 43 linked tales in the story cycle are not stories that the Smithsonian intended to collect, but by the time all the tales are told, their reconstruction of history will make a greater impact on the world around them than either Tova or Swanton could have ever imagined. So that description makes this book sound fairly straightforward, and it really... That was not my experience of reading it. It does jump through time, but it does tell you that those time jumps are happening. So it, each story does have a date as a header, and you can construct a timeline through it. But I kind of enjoyed the jumping around and making you work for it, because I do... Sometimes you want the super easy book that's just gonna say, here's the story, here we go. But sometimes I want to work for it. Sometimes I want to struggle to figure out what's going on and what am I reading. So this book was not an easy read, but it was a really enjoyable read for me. And it's not entirely unlike This Is How You Lose the Time War. If you are a fan of this book and you like the time jumps and you like the lack of straightforward plot and you like the, you know, there's some sapphic romance, there's... But you have to work for it. You have to, like, put in effort to figure out what's going on. So if you like This Is How You Lose the Time War, I would recommend picking up The Dead Go to Seattle, because it is a similar experience to me reading those two books. Which is why This Is How You Lose the Time War gets an honorable mention on this list as another one that I think has the potential to be a favorite book for me. I'm not sure how This Is How You Lose the Time War is going to hold up as a reread, whereas this has a collection of poetry out too, and I would very much like to pick up that book too. So the last book that makes my list of potential favorites that I've read in the last 3 years, this I actually read this year in February. Jess Owens book Communa Read, which is part of her nonfiction book club that's currently on hiatus. And I spend a lot of time in there talking with Bunny and Purple. And Purple was the one who brought up Tome of Sand the first time, because Purple's doing like an around the world reading challenge. So she spends a lot of time looking for translated works and books from around the world. And then Bunny got a copy because Purple sold it really well. And then I was like, well, I feel left out. I want one too. But we had spent a lot of time talking about this particular cover, and we were calling this book the Blue Granny book. Psychedelic granny were the terms we used most often. But the cover for the UK and the US just has like the trunk of a car. It was very boring and didn't make any thematic sense with the story. So my cover is the Indian cover. And so the back of my book actually says for sale in the Indian subcontinent only. I got it on eBay, and I was quite pleased with myself. So in addition to having a stunning cover, this is one of the most beautifully written books I have read in years, decades. This is 730 pages of poetry, essentially, and serious props to Daisy Rockwell, who translated this book, because wow. Wow, 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 wow. In northern India, an 80-year-old woman slips into a deep depression after the death of her husband, and then resurfaces to gain a new lease on life. Her determination to fly in the face of convention, including striking up a friendship with a transgender person, confuses her bohemian daughter, who is used to thinking of herself as the more modern of the two. To her family's consternation, Ma insists on traveling to Pakistan, simultaneously confronting the unresolved trauma of her teenage experiences of partition and reevaluating what it means to be a mother, a daughter, a woman, a feminist. Rather than respond to tragedy with seriousness, Kintanjali Shree's playful tone and exuberant wordplay results in a book that is engaging, funny, and utterly original, at the same time as being an urgent and timely protest against the destructive impact whether between religions, countries, or genders. So, this book is originally written in Hindi. I had never read a novel by an Indian author before. I did not know what partition literature was or meant, so reading this book was a very real educational experience for me. Which I would highly recommend. Don't be intimidated by the fact that Dome of Sand is a tomb. Oh my god, I said that backwards. Tomb of Sand is a dome. So, it looks really chunky, but like, here we go. Like, that's an entire chapter right there. And every chapter, the facing page is blank. So there's like, there's a lot of empty space in the book. So I will say that this book has a lot of, there's not a lot of action happening, if that makes sense. It is definitely not plot driven. It goes off on tangents in weird directions. And we're off. But it's really beautifully written. The language is amazing. The literary devices at play, the metaphors being employed. Well, this one's a simile, not a metaphor, but chapter 21. Breath is like a tiny bug. When it begins to disappear, it's a tiny wisp of a gasp that wriggles free between the gusts of air and the fierce winter chills and the powerful ins and outs of the breaths of everyone else, and escapes like a bug. The little bug burrows into elderly Ma, who lies perfectly still in her bed, trying to squeeze into the hole to escape all the huffing, puffing breaths coming behind her. Just like in holes, the deeper you go, the wider they open. The bug-like breath, a chisel chipping away at its own suffocation, thus creating the hole so that it can pierce the darkness and let there be light, and it will get a puff of air. Air and light, and if it finds water anywhere, a colorful arc will form. A colorful arc. What's that? A bow of rain. A rainbow. That's it. That's the whole chapter. I just read it to you. And the whole book is written like that. So, if you like poetry, this is a fantastic book. If you like very straightforward, this is not going to be your cup of tea. But I think it's a beautiful story of family and religion and gender and feminism and there's a lot of, you know, history of damage done by colonialism. There is a lot of history in general. watched these videos, you've got a decent idea of what my taste in books is at this point. A little weird. Not a lot of plot. Definitely some fantasy elements. And that is me in a nutshell. Safe out.